My name is Leon Els. If you want to make contact with us, you're more than welcome to do so on our website, mnine.com.
The blood of the Lamb changes our lives. It is the Holy Spirit that infuses us that makes a difference. Now, here's the thing. I've got good news. When the enemy comes with a lie, there's some good news. You can achieve anything. And I deliberately use these words. Deliberately, I believe, because this is what the Holy Spirit wants to say to us. You can achieve anything you are called to and stand out in doing so. And if I can keep to the word of God and what he inspires me to do, you are 100% doing exactly what I've written there. You are at that point where you can achieve anything, not just some things. When the enemy says that, listen, you're not good enough, you don't need to believe him. When the enemy says you find yourself in the wrong place, if God has placed you there, this is where you are. You're in the right place. And until God moves you on, you don't go anywhere, because that would be out of his will. You can achieve anything if God has placed you in that situation. You are called to. I want you to get that. Because you can go anywhere but not being called there and then expect anything to happen. It won't. You've got to be called into that area. This is why, as a child of God, we cannot afford to make decisions until we've got word from the Lord. We need to get serious about it. And I promise you, you will stand out in doing so. Now, I want to comfort you and inspire you with this verse in 1 John 5, verse 4. He says, for everyone born of God is victorious and overcomes the world. And this is the victory that has conquered and overcome the world. Our continuing, persistent faith in Jesus Christ. That is what overcomes the world. Now listen, you could take that completely out of context in terms of evangelizing. But even within the scriptures as it is there in verse 4, for everyone born of God is victorious and overcomes the world. What is it in the world? The world wants to belittle you. It wants to make you less than what you are. To say other peoples can do better than you, can minister better. Other people can pray better for others, individuals, in terms of what they need for prayer. Don't believe the lie. For God has no favorites. His word says that he's given you a measure of faith. Who gets the most rewards? Those that use it. Those that use it. Remember the guy with the 10? Multiplied it. The guy with the 5, he multiplied it. The guy with the 1 thought he was very good and he buried it. And then God, the Lord came back, and this is Jesus in the picture. He's the one that went away in the parable. He came back and found that the others have done what they had to do. They multiply. So God has called you to multiply, not to bury away. Can't go and sit in a lazy boy somewhere and just relax waiting on the trumpet to sound for the rapture to take place. God has called you. He's called you to multiply. Another translation says it this way. Every child of God can defeat the world. Isn't that a nice one? Every child of God can defeat the world. And our faith is what gives us this victory. What faith? The faith in our Lord. And that faith could also be said trust. You see, as a young Christian, I had no idea. Faith seems to be something spiritual. I didn't have an understanding for it. But once I started to minister and see what faith really means, it's trusting. It's trusting. You know, one of the analogies that comes to mind when it comes to truly trusting someone is a trapeze artist. You've got two people. The one they call the catcher. The other one is the one that do all the tricks. But you know something, if the catcher is not there, that guy would fall. Or the lady might fall. It is up to the catcher to catch them. swing with them, release them again so that they can catch on. But here's the thing. You speak to any one of those that do the tricks and this will be their answer. I fully trust my catcher. Now, here's the other thing about that analogy, man. I'm excited every time I think about this. When do the catcher comes into play? Once the guy swinging releases himself from his swing. You cannot trust God, fully trust him while you're still swinging. The trust comes in when you say, Lord, not me anymore. I'm completely in your hands. You, my catcher. You get what I'm trying to say? Too many of us have a back door open. We've got a nest egg somewhere stashed away, not trusting fully in the Lord. God taught me that secret early on in ministry. When he called us, had God, this humanly spoken now, had God waited 2 years for me to come into ministry, I would have had my house sorted out completely, vehicles and a nest egg, because we were financially at that point of nearly overbreaching all the overdrafts that we had as a business. So what God says, not later, now. You know what the consequences was? I lost everything. Everything. And then I said, why, Lord? And he said this to me, I will be the one you trust in, not your bank account. I want you to get that. That's trust. And now he says, everyone born of God is victorious and overcome the world by the faith we have in him. Are you ready to trust the Lord in all things? Easy to say yes. Much more difficult to make the commitment. Now, quickly want to continue. The right approach in facing difficulties will make the difference. We all are facing troubles, hassles out there, problems plenty. How do we face those problems? Now, there's some key aspects that will bring us into victory. The right approach in facing difficulties will make the difference between winning or losing, growing or dying. You see, you can't stand still as a Christian. You either grow or you die. That's a reality. There are five P's that I want to cover. That's very pastor-like, eh? Five P's. All right, so let's quickly have a look at those. Get God's perspective. Very important. The second is be a person of prayer. The third one, desire to develop your potential. So there's some action there. Be positive and confident. Expect God to provide. Why would you ask him something and not expect his provision? Those were the five that I will quickly touch. And we're going to use scriptures so that you have some Bible study material after the meeting. So the very first point that we will be looking at there is get God's perspective. In other words, take a step back. Take a step back. I have found that the biggest problem I have with spectacles, with glasses, when we walk on the beach. I only find out after I left the beach that I can hardly see through the lenses. Because you're so close to the lenses, you don't see all the mist that is gathered on the lens. So by the time I take it off and I look at it, I see, well, this needs a cleaning. It's a reality. You're too close to it. And sometimes we need to just take a step back. Stop complaining. Just step back. Speak to God about it. Don't face it directly. Step back. Get God's perspective on it. Take a step back. The verse there that I would like to quote to you is 2 Kings 6 and there verse 15. Now, you know Elijah, of course, with this story. And when the servant of the man of God arose early and went out, there was an army surrounding. I'm reading verse 15. We'll get to 16 just now. Surrounding the city with horses and chariots. And his servant said to him, "Alas, my master, what shall we do?" And here's the answer in verse 16. He says, "So he answered, 'Do not fear. For those who are with us are more than those who are with them. If that is my attitude towards any problem, you cannot but overcome. If you realize that God is greater than any situation, it changes your attitude. And then verse 17, and Elijah prayed and said, Lord, I pray, open his eyes that he might see. Then the Lord opened the eyes of the young man and he saw. And behold, the mountain was full of horses and chariots of fire all around Elijah. Now, to me, I could just preach on this section because it is so exciting. Elijah didn't call them to be on the mountain all around them. They were there all along. But he had to pray for the servant to also see it. So you might be stepping into a situation that you have no idea. What you can't see is a ring of angels for the protection. And when you move in faith, it ignites the ministry of the angels. But if you are fearful about it, the angels cannot move on your behalf. Don't get dogmatic about it. But what I'm saying to you is, they are there. And knowing that determines your attitude. Now I can face the enemy because there's more for us than for the enemy. Yeah, but you don't see who I'm facing right now. No, just look behind them. See what God is busy doing. And the moment you begin to rise up in the authority of knowing that God is greater than anything else, you begin to move with that boldness. You get God's perspective. Should I worry? No. Should I be anxious? No. Because the word of God says be anxious of some things. Nothing. Not of anything. So be obedient to the word of God. Now, don't look at the problem. Look at the promise. One of God's promises is, I will never leave or forsake you. Matthew 28, verse 20. Never leave nor forsake you. That's a promise God makes. So why should I doubt him? God is no man, the word of God says, that he would lie. God makes a promise, he keeps it. Now, in Romans 8, 28, and you know this verse very, very well, but it is worth looking at it again because I normally look at the scripture and begin to divide it up in sections. Because some people want to just hold on to the promise there, but there's a condition to it. He says there, and we know that all things work together for good to those who love God. Remember, how do I prove that I love him? I follow his commandments. So if someone don't follow his commandments, they cannot say they love him. And then the promise in this section won't count for them. So what is my first priority in order to get God's perspective? Is to know what God commands. Because once I do that, I do whatever I do because I love him. And because I love him, get this. He says, to those who are the called according to his purpose, we know that all things will work together. So God makes a promise to those that love him. If you make a study of love him through the Bible, there's quite a number of verses that makes that kind of statement. A promise, but that's the condition. Love him. Now, the second point there, be a person of prayer. In other words, give it to the Lord. Give it to God. Pray about it. Give it to him. And you know, I've learned a lesson. If you give it to the Lord, don't hold on to it. Let God do it his way. Very often we want to dictate how God should answer our prayers. And we very often get to a point where we think we know what's good for us. God knows better. Let God have his way. Give it to the Lord. 1 Thessalonians 5. Verse 17, he says, be unceasing and persistent in prayer. I love this translation. Unceasing means Don't stop. Because you're facing problem all the time. That's a reality. But how can you pray for 24 hours a day? Well, that's not what it says. Unceasing there means that I've got an open line to God all the time. So when I want to speak, it's there. It should be the first thing you do. When there's a hiccup, the first thing I should do, Lord, how can I get this sorted? Show me. That's prayer. First John, or rather, when we pray, coincidences happen. I love that phrase. I must confess, I borrowed it somewhere some years ago. Can't remember where I got it, but this is so true. I always hold on to it. When we pray, coincidences happen. When you pray, you meet up with a Czech lady at the counter. It's a coincidence. It's a God instance. You get that? God make the arrangement. There's nothing coincidental about a prayer life. God aligns it. But then, of course, some of you would remember this. When we, 1 John 5:15, he says, and if we know that God listens when we pray, and do we? We are sure that our prayers have already been answered. Man, that excites me. Absolutely excites me. Before I ask, God already knows what I'm going to ask him. He's already prepared it. The package awaits my call. I thank the Lord it's not an Amazon package. God's packages will arrive undamaged. He's already got it in place. By the time I pray, it comes out of his stockroom. Right up for me, because God knows. But if you don't pray, you don't get your package. That's the reality. So prayer is very important. So how do I pray? Well, I love this. Adopt the push attitude in your prayer life. Remember push? Push is pray until something happens. Pray until something happens. It is like giving birth. The lady don't decide halfway through her birth pangs, that's it. I'm not going on with this one. That it won't happen. So God says, keep pushing. Because there's something to be birthed from your prayer life. And because we don't spend enough time in prayer, we don't see something born from our prayer life. Push. Let's get this baby going. All right. That's what it's all about. The third point. Desire to develop your potential. In other words, make space. When God delivers a package, it's big. It's not going to come through the letterbox. You'll have to open the door. That's the God that we serve. 1 Corinthians 2:9. He says, but as it is written, I love it when it says that. I have not seen, nor ear heard, neither have entered into the heart of man the things that God hath prepared for them that love him. Again, that phrase. That God has prepared. Listen, I've heard so many sermons on that portion pointing towards the new heaven and the new earth. Once we leave this earth, that's not what that word says. That scripture within context says that God has already prepared things here now for the now ready for you to come into. But God has already prepared. It is beyond your wildest dreams, but God has prepared. That's what the verse there says. It says what you have not dreamt, what you have not even thought about, what God has already prepared for you. So the moment that we begin to say, Lord, I'm making space. I'm opening up my life for your blessing. I'm expecting it, Lord. Move your tent pins. Widen your tent so that God can fill it in. I don't want to limit God in terms of his blessing. We have no idea how many people God really touches by the word that's been ministered the way that we do it. When I look at the numbers on YouTube that actually visit just what we have as recording there, it is way more than the congregation. Way more. But then we get to the place where so many people get the audio message by the hundreds. Same word. You see, we can't even begin to think what God has planned. So let's not limit him in terms of what God wants to do. Your environment determines your growth. In other words, if my mind is set on growth, it will be so. If you've only got a small room for blessing and it fills up, you're not expecting more, how many people will you affect? You need to be in a place, I'm just not happy with what we had. Last week was a wonderful time again in the presence of God. I'm not happy with that. We want to see, or let me rephrase that. I'm not content with just that. I want to see greater things happen. And greater things to me would be when each one of us begin to reach out and make a difference. It's not about a pulpit ministry. Get this, Romans 8:11. He says, but if the spirit of him that raised Jesus from the dead dwell in you, he that raised Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies by his spirit that dwelleth in you. In other words, never ever say that I can't take this anymore. Because the word of God also says that God will not allow you to be tested beyond what you are able to bear. All temptation that come your way is only a human temptation. He says, and when you get stuck, that's what the word there says in Greek, he will come and pick you up and carry you out of that situation. That's the God that we serve. And in this verse now, he says, if the spirit of him that raised Jesus from the dead dwell in you, he that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal body. Listen, when I made a study on what actually happened with the resurrection, it is absolutely amazing. Can you imagine that body be lifted up, changed in a moment? What power to swap the earthly for a glorified body? Power of the Holy Spirit. We have so much going for us, so don't let the enemy steal away anything from you. The enemy will have you believe that you are unable to succeed. That's his biggest project. You remember when we spoke about the helm of salvation, the reason for it? He comes with one way and he plays mind games with you. And when you take that mind game on and you begin to think about it, he cannot manipulate you. I want you to understand that. It is you falling for his lie that do the things that should not have happened. He cannot manipulate you. As a child of God in particular, it's what we allow him to do that makes a difference. So the enemy will have you believe that you are unable to succeed. John 14, verse 12. Verily, verily. You know, when Jesus uses these two words, he's serious. Listen, listen very carefully. I've got something to say to you. It's what he's saying. I say unto you, he that believeth in me, the works that I do, shall he do also. Now, wouldn't that have been enough? But then he goes on. And greater works than these shall he do, because I go unto my Father. And as a young Christian, I couldn't make sense of that phrase. Because Jesus did everything, didn't he? The dead rose and all the healing and everything. What greater can I do? What he's saying there is that you, to me, is plural. that says, now you're a bigger team. So everything I've done, you will be able to duplicate. And it will be so much more than what I've done as an individual. This is why I go to my Father. And then Jesus directs us. How do we pray? Whatever you ask, in my name of the Father will be given unto you. But then we know the will of God and it happens. Praise the Lord for that. Fourth one, and I'm trying to rush through. Be positive and confident. In other words, stand tall. I love this one in particular because of David. David must have thought, Goliath is too big to miss. He saw this problem. Some people quivered. They were afraid and fearful all in the army. David said, what? That guy is so big, I can't miss him. Now, if that is our attitude, how many Goliaths would you have slain by now? This is a huge problem, huge situation in front of me. Fact is, I can't miss it. I've got the word of God in my sling. Can't miss it. That built me up. Every time I think of that phrase, it is like, man, how can I make so much of a problem? If it's big, they fall harder. Okay. 1 Samuel 17, verse 4. He says, and the champion went out of the camp of the Philistines named Goliath and of Gath, whose height was 6 cubits and a span about 10 feet tall with this guy. So just to confirm that David stood in front of him and he took up the challenge. In the name of my God, he said. So when the problem comes and the enemy brings a problem to you, you stand before it and says, in the name of the God that I serve, you cannot be missed in terms of being overcome because God is the one that supplied for me. 1 John 4:4, you are of God, little children, and have overcome them because greater is he that is in you than he that's in the world. How often do we quote that scripture? We should keep on quoting it. You are of God, and I love this, little children. So to me, it just says, it's not in your power to fight Goliath. If it was a hand-to-hand battle, David would have lost. But using the instruments that God has trained him up with made the difference. Can't miss. Can't miss. The last one there, number 5. Expect God's provision. There should be an expectancy that God will provide. God has great resources. Psalm 84, verse 11, and I think it's verse 12 in the Slovak. 84, 11 says, for the Lord God is a sun and shield. The Lord will give grace and glory. No good thing will be withheld from them that walk uprightly. No good thing will be withheld from those that walk uprightly. So the question is, are we walking uprightly? If we don't trust in the catcher, if we don't trust in the Lord, then you're not upright. If you trust in him, that will make the difference. The word says there, for God is this, a sun and a shield. In other words, he brings light, but he also brings us shade in times when the enemy wants to attack us. Ephesians 3, verse 20. He says, now unto him that is able to do, I love this, exceedingly, I love the adjectives, exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us. I want you to pick up on that one. What is this power? The faith and the Holy Spirit that is within us. So if we are loaded up with the Holy Spirit, that power within us will make the difference. Why believe a lie? And I think that is the important question. You can do it. You can do it. We can overcome individually. We need one another, that's true, but we need the Lord more than anything else. Don't look at the problem, look at the promise. I said that again because this is important. This is important. Get on with it. You can with God. Why allow the enemy to halt you, bring you to a standstill when God has a vision for you, a purpose for you? He wants you to fulfill your purpose completely, not half. And never mind your age, how young or old you are, who you are, what you are doing. God uses all his instruments. We're part of the same body. And sometimes we just need to listen more than what we speak. Get overexcited and we say more than what we should. Say, Lord, guide me, lead me to what I need. And then I want to close with this verse, which to me also very important. Mark 10:27. It says, Yeshua looked at them and said, humanly, it is impossible, but not with God. With God, everything is possible. Do you believe that? Everything. Those words are very important to me. Because listen what he says. Humanly, it's impossible, but not with God. With God, everything is possible. So when you face the next situation that seems to be too big, remember you can't miss it. You've got prayer. You've got the power of God. And those 5 points, get God's perspective, be a person of prayer, desire to develop your potential. It is my responsibility. My expectancy, be positive and confident, and then expect God to provide. Let's bow our heads. Praise his name. Father, we just want to thank you that, again, you've given us a way to overcome whatever the enemy wants to bring against us. It's exciting times, Lord. When we look around us, we see that everything is crumbling. And we know that Maranatha, you soon and soon, you will come for your bride. But Father, we've got so much still to do. And we pray that we will not be found to be slumbering or sleeping, Lord, but be awake to your call so that we might make a change in the life of people, Lord, so that they might come to know you. Let that be our desire. But most of all, Lord, that we love you and want to please you. And Lord, I pray that we will always have your perspective over every situation that confronts us, standing back and allowing you, Lord, to take care of it. I now pray, Father, for this seed to remain in our hearts and it be fruitful, Lord, and that we begin to apply what you are giving us through your Holy Spirit so that we might become stronger. Lord, I also pray that through the course of this week, as we will soon depart, one from the other, that your name will be glorified in all that we do, but that we will be as called ones, Lord, begin to speak more about what you want us to say than speaking about all the things that's happening in the world. Lord, all these things will pass away, but your word will remain, and that has eternal influence. Pray, Lord, that you will guide us and lead us, that we will open our heart to receive that power of the Holy Spirit that is way beyond the understanding of the world, and that we might touch and change, not just our own life, but the life of others. We pray this in the wonderful name of Yeshua, our Savior. Praise his name.